Alhamdulillah wa kafa was salatu was salamu ala man la nabiyya ba'da wa ba'd. Inshallah, before I begin with the tafsir, I'm just letting everyone know in Surah Ra'd, the 13th surah, ayah 15, there is a sign of sajda. I have already read it and done my sajda, but it is a personal position on whether you're going to do so after the class. It's a sunnah mu'akkada, not a wajiba, or whether you'll do it during so. I will keep reading through, so you won't miss anything, inshallah, but it's your call on how you want to organize it. We're beginning from Surah Ra'd, the 13th surah, ayat 14 onwards. Imam ibn Jawzi rahimahullah, he says, quote, "It must be understood, when the Exalted One has said that he is Shdidul Mihal, that he has all might and all power, and we understand that we don't take anything from the attributes of Allah other than what he has said. We do not attribute any faults, inconsistencies, weaknesses, diminishing aspects to Allah. All of his attributes, exalted be he, mighty and majestic is he, are noble. So we would never give Allah attributes that have not been agreed upon by the book, the sunnah, or the consensus. The Exalted One has said further, لَهُ دَعْوَةُ الْحَقُّ وَالَّذِينَ يَدَعُونَ مِنْ دُونِهِ لَا يَسْتَجِيبُ لَهُمْ بِشَيْءٍ إِلَّا كَبَاسِطِ كَفَّيْهِ إِلَى الْمَاءِ إلى الماء ليبلغ فاه وما هو ببالغه وما دعاء الكافرين إلا في ضلال ولله يسجد من في السماوات والأرض طوعا وكرها وظلالهم بالغدو والأصال قُلْ مَنْ رَبُّ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ قُلِ اللَّهِ قُلْ أَفَاتَّخَذْتُمْ مِنْ دُونِهِ أَوْلِيَاءَ أَلَا يَمْلِكُونَ لِأَنفُسِهِمْ نَفْعًا وَلَا ضَرًّا قُلْ هَلْ يَسْتَوِي الْأَعْمَى وَالْبَصِيرُ أَمْ هَلْ تَسْتَوِي الظُّلُمَاتُ وَالنُّورُ أَمْ جَعَلُوا لِلَّهِ شُرَكَاءَ خَلَقُوا كَخَلْقِهِ فَتَشَابَهَ الْخَلْقُ عَلَيْهِمْ قُلِ اللَّهُ خَالِقُ كُلِّ شَيْءٍ وَهُوَ الْوَاحِدُ الْقَهَّارُ أَنْزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً فسالت أودية بقدرها فاحتمل السيل زبدا رابيا ومما يوقدون عليه في النار ابتغاء حلية أو متاع زبد مثله كذلك يضرب الله الحق والباطل فأما الزبد فيذهب جفاء وأما ما ينفع الناس فيمكث في الأرض كذلك يضرب الله الأمثال للذين استجابوا لربهم الحسنى والذين لم يستجيبوا له لو أن لهم ما في الأرض جميعا ومثله معه لافتدوا به أولئك لهم سوء الحساب ومأواهم جهنم وبئس المهاد أفمن يعلم أنما أنزل إليك من ربك الحق كمن هو أعمى إنما يتذكر أولو الألباب الذين يوفون بعهد الله ولا ينقضون الميثاق والذين يصلون ما أمر الله به أن يوصل ويخشون ربهم ويخافون سوء الحساب والذين صبروا ابتغاء وجه ربهم وأقاموا الصلاة وأنفقوا مما رزقناهم سرا وعلانية ويدرؤون بالحسنة السيئة أولئك لهم عقبى الدار جنات عدن يدخلونها ومن صلح من آبائهم وأزواجهم وذرياتهم والملائكة يدخلون عليهم من كل باب سلام عليكم بما صبرتم فنعم عقبى الدار والذين ينقضون عهد الله من بعد ميثاقه ويقطعون ما أمر الله به أن يوصل ويفسدون في الأرض أولئك لهم اللعنة ولهم سوء الدار الله يبسط الرزق لمن يشاء ويقدر وفرحوا بالحياة الدنيا وما الحياة الدنيا في الآخرة إلا متاع ويقول الذين كفروا لولا أنزل عليه آية من ربه قل إن الله يضل من يشاء ويهدي إليه من أناب الذين آمنوا وتطمئن قلوبهم بذكر الله ألا بذكر الله تطمئن القلوب الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات طوبى لهم وحسن مآب كذلك أرسلناك في أمة قد خلت من قبلها أمم لتتلو عليهم الذي أوحينا إليك وهم يكفرون بالرحمن قل هو ربي لا إله إلا هو عليه توكلت وإليه متاب ولو أن قرآنا سيرت به الجبال أو قطعت به الأرض أو كلم به الموتى بل لله الأمر جميعا أفلم يأس الذين آمنوا أن لو يشاء الله لهدى الناس جميعا ولا يزال الذين كفروا تصيبهم بما صنعوا قارعة أو تحل قريبا من دارهم حتى يأتي وعد الله إن الله لا يخلف الميعاد ولقد استهزئ برسل من قبلك فأمليت للذين كفروا ثم أخذتهم فكيف كان عقاب أفمن هو قائم على كل نفس بما كسبت وجعلوا لله شركاء قل سموهم أم تنبئونه بما لا يعلم في الأرض أم بظاهر من القول بل زين للذين كفروا مكرهم وصدوا عن السبيل ومن يضلل الله فما له من هاد لهم عذاب في الحياة الدنيا ولعذاب الآخرة أشق وما لهم من الله من واق مثل الجنة التي وعد المتقون تجري من تحتها الأنهار أكلها دائم وظلها تلك عقبى الذين اتقوا وعقبى الكافرين النار والذين آتيناهم الكتاب يفرحون بما أنزل إليك ومن الأحزاب من ينكر بعضه قل إنما أمرت أن أعبد الله ولا أشرك به إليه أدعو وإليه مآب وكذلك أنزلناه حكما عربيا ولئن اتبعت أهواءهم بعد ما جاءك من العلم ما لك من الله من ولي ولا واق ولقد أرسلنا رسلا من قبلك وجعلنا لهم أزواجا وذرية وما كان لرسول أن يأتي بآية إلا بإذن الله لكل أجل كتاب يمحو الله ما يشاء ويثبت وعنده أم الكتاب وإما نرينك بعض الذي نعدهم أو نتوفينك فإنما عليك البلاغ وعلينا الحساب أولم يروا أنا نأتي الأرض ننقصها من أطرافها والله يحكم لا معقب لحكمه وهو سريع الحساب وقد مكر الذين من قبلهم فلله المكر جميعا يعلم ما تكسب كل نفس وسيعلم الكفار لمن عقب الدار ويقول الذين كفروا لست مرسلا قل كفى بالله شهيدا بيني وبينكم ومن عنده علم الكتاب
To him is the true call of worship, and those who they call on from besides him, they are unable to answer at all. Just like the one who stretches out his hands to water, beckoning that it reaches his mouth, but it doesn't reach his mouth. The prayer of the unbelievers bears nothing but a strainous indeed. And to Allah, everything in the skies and the earth prostrates willingly and unwillingly, as well as their shadows, willingly and unwillingly, in the morning and the evenings. Say, who is the Lord of the skies and the earth? Say, Allah. Say, is it then the case that you've taken from besides him protectors who have no ownership or power over themselves in terms of benefit or harm? Say, are the blind and the seeing equal? Or are the shadows and the light equal? Or have they made for Allah partners that they created like his creation so it resembles the creation? Say, Allah is the creator of everything, and he is the unique, the dominant and victorious at all times. He sent down from the sky water in which streams start flowing according to their measure, and they don't transgress that. Then the torrents of wind takes away the foam that rises to the surface. And then from the things that melt into the fire for making ornaments and other articles, water is used for that and raises up a scum like it. Allah does explain the example of truth and falsehood so that you might know. The useless filth passes away as something worthless, and the thing that is good for the people lasts on the earth. Allah then makes these examples for the human race. For those who obey and answer their Lord in goodness, and for those who do not obey and answer his call, then even if they had all that's in the earth together, to offer as a sacrifice for their being safe from the judgment, it would be of no use for them. These are those who are lost, and they have a severe accounting to come. Their home is the great fire, and what an evil resting place indeed that is for them. Is it then the case that someone only knows, that one, what's been sent down to you from your Lord? Is that one like the one who's blind? No, those who accept admonition are those men of understanding. Those same ones who fulfill their covenant with Allah, and they do not violate the covenant they made. those who put together that which Allah has not commanded to be joined, and hold their Lord, those who join that which Allah has commanded to be brought together, and they fear their Lord, and they fear the wrath of a judgment to come, those who are patient and seek the face of their Lord, they establish the prayer and spend of that which we have sustained them with, in secret and in open. And they also enjoin one another with goodness after sin, and they repent from sin. These are the people who have the best abode. They have gardens everlasting they will enter in. And those from their forefathers, their wives, and their offspring. And there will be angels present as well that will enter upon them from every gate, saying, peace be upon you because of how steadfast you were. How excellent is the way of the hereafter that there is now. Those who violate the covenant from after confirming it and cut the ties which Allah has commanded to be brought together. And they spread tribulation in the earth and cause corruption. They have the judgment of the curse, and they have the worst outcome. Allah is the one who sends down the provision to whoever He wills, and He straightens and stops the provision for who He wills. The unbelievers, they take pleasure in their comforts. But the fact is that the life of this world is only a brief enjoyment compared to what's coming in the hereafter. Those who reject faith say, why is there not sent down upon him some sign from his Lord regarding this matter? Say, Allah leads astray who He wills, and He guides who He wills. To him, whoever is sincere and has a pure heart. Those who believe and their hearts are filled with tranquility in the remembrance of Allah, is it not in the remembrance of Allah that the hearts find tranquility? Those who believe and they do righteous deeds, good news to them and a good ending. Just as we sent you in a nation that's already passed from before, nations had come, they had recited upon them that which we revealed to you, and they reject faith in the Most Merciful. Say, He is my Lord, there's no God but Him. I put my trust in Him, and I am patient with all that He aligns. If there had come down a Quran in which mountains were moved because of it, or the earth was split asunder with earthquakes, or the dead were resurrected, they would still not believe. On the contrary, Allah has the command over all affairs. Do not the unbelievers know that if Allah had willed, He could have guided all the people? But His will is that which is to be carried out. And the unbelievers continue to stumble in the darkness. Indeed, Allah does not break His promise. Messengers before your time were mocked, and the unbelievers were given time for a little while. Then they were seized by myself. So look at how terrible was my judgment. Is it then the one who watches over every soul according to what it earns, like their idols that they worship? No, not at all. Those who associate and set up partners with Allah, tell them, name your idols. Tell the idols. Who are these idols that inform Allah of that which He has done? Who are they that inform Him of that which He knows, which no one else in the whole earth knows? Or are you merely speaking loosely? Indeed, the evil wickedness and the plans that they have brought, their bad deeds are only fair seeming to them, and they have been kept back from the right path. And Allah guides astray who He wills, and whoever Allah leads astray, there is no one to guide it. Those who are led astray have the wrath in this earthly life and the greatest wrath to come in the hereafter. And they have no protection from Allah. The likeness of the paradise which was promised the pious under which rivers flow, and it lasts for everlasting. Its fruit and shade is eternal. That is the end abode for those who are righteous and fear their Lord, while the end result for the unbelievers is the great fire. Those who we gave them the book, they know, and they rejoice in that which has been revealed. Now there are some who reject some of that which has been revealed. Say, I worry not about your opposition. I've been commanded to worship Allah and not to associate any partners with Him. So I call you to Allah, for return to Him is the end return of everything. Likewise, we have sent down a clear judgment in Arabic. And if you were to follow their desires after knowledge had come to you, you would have had no protector and no one to shield you from Allah. We have sent many messengers from before you, and we have made for them wives and posterity. It's not possible for a messenger to bring any sign except with the permission of Allah. For every single term and every single judgment, there is a preserved book. Allah wipes out what He pleases, and He establishes that which He pleases. And with Him is the source of the book and all things. If we show you some of the judgment which we had threatened the unbelievers with, or we lift you up to us, you would have seen the truth. But instead, it is only for you to command them with that which we have conveyed. Don't they see that gradually everything is being reduced and it is being... Do they not see that everything is gradually being reduced and boiled down? Allah gives the command, and none reverses the command of Allah. He is the swift in calling to account. There were those before who were plotting, but Allah knows all the plots, and Allah will punish them all for what they plan. He knows what every soul shall earn, and the unbelievers will come to know the end judgment in the hereafter. The unbelievers say, "You're not a messenger that's been sent." Say, "Allah alone is sufficient as a witness for me between myself and you, and also those who possess knowledge of the book. They are sufficient witnesses." Surah Ra'ad, the 13th surah, ayat 14 to 43. The Exalted One has said He has the call of truth. The call of truth in this instance is referring to the word of Tawheed, La ilaha illallah. This is the understanding of Ali ibn Abi Talib, Ibn Abbas, and the vast majority of scholars. So what this means is that the call of truth, He has given it already. He has sent it out. And there are those who are meant to accept the call of truth, and those who are not. And He, Allah, one of His names is Al-Haq, the truth. So whoever calls to Allah is calling with the call of truth, as mentioned by Al-Hasan al-Basri. Now those idols that they call on from besides Allah, they do not answer them, meaning that they don't speak. These idols don't speak and they have no power. They are not like anything except like a man coming to water and spreading out his hand to it. Now, there are five statements regarding this parable. This parable, in one statement, is referring to the fact that the thirsty man stretches his hand out to the well to raise water to him to drink, but it doesn't reach him. As mentioned by Ali ibn Abi Talib alayhi salam and Ata. The second point to this parable is that the thirsty man, when he places his hands on the water, if he doesn't raise it, it won't come to him. So it is futile. As mentioned by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. Number three is that the thirsty man, in his mind, wants to reach the water that's far away. He wants to reach the water, but he's not able to do so. As mentioned by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. So these three statements are showing that the parable is taken in the form as it's looking at. Those who they call on someone besides Allah, they can't answer them at all, except like a man trying to raise water to his mouth by merely spreading out his hands, meaning that they're impotent. Number four is that the man who's calling the water with his tongue and pointing to it with his hand, nothing will ever come to him, for he is impotent. And this is mentioned by the student of Ibn Abbas, Mujahid. The number five and final point is that the one who's raised his hands to take the water and has called it to come to his mouth, nothing comes to him. The Arabs have an expression where they say, whoever seeks what he can't find, then he's trying to raise water without a bucket. When Allah the Exalted says, the call of the unbelievers is nothing except astrayness. Now there are two statements on what this means. The first is that it means the dua of the unbelievers when they call on their Lord, it's astrayness because their voices are veiled from Allah answering their supplications. This ruling was narrated from Ad-Dahhak, from Ibn Abbas. The second statement is that the worship of that the unbelievers give to the idols is nothing but loss and folly, as said by Muqatil. Then Allah says, and Allah, for Allah, to Allah there prostrates all of what's in the skies and the earth, willingly and unwillingly. And their shadows also prostrate, and the morning and the evening. Now this is one of the verses of prostration. Allah the Exalted says, whatever's in the skies and the earth prostrates to him, meaning the angels. And in the earth, this is to do specifically with human beings, the believers from among the human beings. Willingly and unwillingly. Now, what does it mean when it's stated in the ayah that there are some who prostrate to Allah unwillingly or by force? There are three rulings regarding this matter. The first is that the one who's prostrating to Allah, who entered Islam because of the sword, he is prostrating due to force exerted on him, as said by Ibn Zayd. So this one is prostrating due to coercion being placed upon him. Number two is the shadow of the unbeliever does prostrate to Allah. So although his body doesn't because he rejects, his shadow does respond, and this is the coercion, as mentioned by Muqatil. Number three is the prostration of the one that's been forced. He's been led to prostrate because he humiliates himself and submits himself to what Allah wants from him. And he asks for Allah's pardon. He He asks for Allah's help regarding illness, health, wealth, poverty. This individual is coerced to prostrate because he's driven to his knees by the desire to submit to his Lord and to submit himself to the commands of Allah the Exalted. And when it's mentioned in the ayah that their shadows prostrate, the shadows of the people that prostrate, they prostrate willingly or by coercion. And their prostration is by the shadows moving from one side to the other as the sun travels across the celestial hemisphere. The shadows become long then short. This is their prostration. And shadows respond to the movement of the sun. So it can be said with correctness, with a correct understanding, that the unbeliever prostrates to other than Allah, while his shadow prostrates to Allah. This is indeed a correct statement. Close quote. Now, just a very quick point I want to mention. That's regarding the last two statements. It mentions that the dua of the unbelievers is in astrayness. Now, the scholars have commented upon this, and what they state is that this particular ayah, the dua of the unbelievers is in astrayness, ayah 14. They say that in general, when unbelievers are doing their idolatry, none of their dua is valid. But, when an unbeliever is in the throes of tribulation and he calls on Allah alone and abandons his idols, Allah answers that dua. The evidence that the scholars bring is when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam came back to Mecca, one of the people that fled believing he would be killed was Ikrimah, the son of Abu Jahl. He flees with two other men. They get aboard a ship because they're sailors by their profession. A massive storm strikes them while they're at sea. They all call out on Allah. They leave all other idols. They call, they say, "O Allah, if you spare our lives, we will go back to Muhammad and put our hands in his and become Muslim. Spare our lives." The storm subsides. The ship is blown back to shore. Ikrimah makes his way. The other two, they renege on what they said. Ikrimah gets back to Mecca, puts his hand in the hands of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, becomes Muslim, and perfects, he becomes one of the great ones among the companions. It is from him that we get the well-known and authentic tradition of kissing the Quran and touching it to the forehead, in which he said, "This is the speech of my Lord, this is the book of my Lord." It is from him that we get this practice of the companions, where he did this consistently. None of the companions ever stopped him. Why? Because it's a permitted practice. Now, this has been narrated through many different channels, but the most famous narrator of it is Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. He narrates this in his book. So the narrator of this hadith is strong. He's sound. His name is Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. He is one of the four successors of Sheikh Abdul Qadir Al-Jilani. Sheikh Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. He died in 600 Hijri. He memorized 700,000 700,000 ahadith out of all 1 million ahadith. He memorized 700,000 and used to pray 300 rak'ah out of gratitude to Allah every day until he died. He is the one that brought what we are calling Qadiriyah to Egypt. He's the one that brought Sheikh Abdul Qadir Jilani's books, his amal, his methodology, his understanding, this his way of stringent practice of Islam. He brought this to Egypt. The book that this hadith from Ikrimah is narrated in, so I've gave you the name of the sheikh, the book is called Al-Iqtisad. So the book is by Sheikh Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. The book is called Al-Iqtisad. And it's under the chapter of the Quran and respecting it. It's authentic. There's no dispute about Sheikh Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. No intelligent one who knows about hadith disputes him. He's considered, he's one of the people who's called Amirul Mu'mineen in hadith. There are only a handful of people called the leader of the believers in hadith. One of them is Ibn Hajj al-Asqalani. One of them is Abdul Wahid ibn Abdul Ghani al-Maqdisi. Abdul Ghani ibn Abdul Wahid al-Maqdisi. And there's only a small handful of others. So when the unbeliever calls on Allah, the scholars say, he leaves his idols, then that dua, Allah accepts that. Now if they renege, then whatever idols that they call on after that, Allah doesn't accept that. But every time they leave the idols and call on him and him alone, he accepts that. Because they're only calling on him and him alone. Now, regarding the three types of things that are meant by the prostration by force, it says the prostration of the one who entered Islam with the sword. What is this referring to? This is referring to, in the time of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the hypocrites, when they became Muslim, these were people who were mentioned in Surah Al-Baqarah on the second page of Surah Al-Baqarah as not believing in Allah but externally showing belief. Those people were scared that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam would kill them if they showed unbelief. Why would they be scared of that? Because the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in the hadith in the Sahih of Imam Muslim, "Umirtu an uqatil an-nas hatta yashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa anna Muhammadur Rasulullah wa yuqimu as-salah." وَيُتُّ الزَّكَاةَ فَإِذَا فَعَلُوا ذَلِكَ عَصَمُوا مِنِّي دِمَاءَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ وَحِسَابُهُمْ عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى إِلَّا بِحَقِّ الْإِسْلَامِ وَحِسَابُهُمْ عَلَى اللَّهِ تَعَالَى. I have been ordered to fight the people. I have been ordered to fight the people until they say, there is no God but Allah and Muhammad is the messenger of Allah. To establish, and they establish the prayer, and they give the zakah. When they do that, their wealth is safe from me, except a right from Islam on their wealth. And their reckoning is on Allah. All scholars of hadith, including Imam Nawawi, say that the nas that the Prophet ﷺ is talking to is not the human race. It's the Arabs. Because he, when he came to the Arabs to fight them, he would not accept jizya from the Arabs. But he would from the Jews and Christians. Surah At-Tawbah, the ninth surah, ayah 29. Why? Because the Arabs are the sons of prophets and they are supposed to know better. So for the Arabs, when the Arabs apostated, when the Arabs rejected, what happened to them? They were killed. They were killed. Because they're supposed to know better. So this hadith means those Arabs, and who are your hypocrites? The hypocrites are the Arabs. And these ayat and these ahadith, the hypocrites are the Arabs. Those people that came into Islam, manifesting it externally, but rejecting it internally because they were scared they might be killed or they might be found out, so they manifested it. So they're prostrating out of force. They're prostrating because of force. And they would come to the masjid, they would frequent the masjid for all five salawat to make sure that they weren't caught out. Because of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ where he said, I prepared firewood when I saw
some men absent from the congregational prayer. What stopped me from burning their houses down with them in it is I saw children and women inside. This is the emphasis on the prayer in jama'ah for men. If you can't do it at the masjid, then pray in jama'ah at home. But the jama'ah, the emphasis on in this hadith was the importance of jama'ah, praying in jama'ah. So the hypocrites, they understood that. So they would frequent the masjid. They were there for all five salawat. Sometimes they would be in the jihad to make sure they weren't caught or found out. But sometimes Allah would expose the matter. So this hadith, when it says that they entered, this statement, when it says they entered into Islam because of the sword, that's referring to the hypocrites or the Arabs who entered in with delegations because they were scared of being killed. It doesn't mean that we're to go and enter people into Islam with the sword or the AK or the Kalashnikov or whatever it is. We're not to enter them into Islam based upon that. This is talking about a specific group of people. Imam Ibn Jawzi rahimahullah, he then says, quote, when the Exalted One says, say, who is the Lord of the skies and the earth? Say Allah. The reason why this ayah has been brought in this way is because of how it was revealed. Both the question and the answer came in one moment. Because the idol worshippers weren't denying that Allah created everything, whereas they didn't deny that. He was asking the question and then immediately answering it. But what he was saying is by answering the question, this was a proof against them. He said, say, are you taking from besides him protectors, meaning idols? You're turning to them and you're worshiping the idols, and they don't own anything in terms of benefit or harm. They have no power for themselves. How is it you're worshiping these idols and they can't defend themselves? Then Allah gave the example of the one who worships the idol and the one who worships Allah. When he said, are the blind and the seeing the same? The blind and the seeing, the blind one is the idol worshiper, and the one who has vision is the believer. Is the darkness and the light, are they both the same? Now, with regards to the recitation of Ibn Kathir, Nafi', Abu Amr, Ibn Amir, and Hafs ibn Asim, they recite the ayah, Am hal tastawi dhulumatu wan nur. However, Hamza, Kasai, Abu Bakr, and Abu Bakr, narrating from Asim, recited as, Hal yastawi, with a yeah. But both are valid. So, are the darkness and the light the same? Meaning, are the shirk, which is darkness, and the light, which is iman, are they equal? Have they made for Allah partners? So have the partners that they made for Allah, have they created anything like his creation? Have they anything that resembles the creation of Allah? Have these people created anything? The question being asked in this ayah is not awaiting an answer. The question is being asked in the form of a rebuke. It means that they haven't created anything. The question is being asked to rebuke, to refute, and to negate. They know that Allah alone is the one who is the creator, or they should know, and not other than him. No one has created anything, but Allah has created all things. And he, Allah, says that he's the creator of everything. Now, one can find, according to the statement of Az-Zajjaj, that it's clear that one of the greatest indications in this surah is that Allah is the creator of everything. This has been clearly noted. And because Allah is the creator of everything, Allah follows up the statement by saying he is Al-Wahid, the unique, and Al-Qahhar, which means he has no partners in his essence, in his actions, and in his attributes. And when Allah says he sent down from the sky water in the form of rain to send forward streams that water valleys. And valleys normally occur between two mountains as a process of erosion. And the rainwater that falls, that causes erosion, what generally happens is these areas are flooded and the water that carves and erodes out the canyons
rises to the top and runs off once it's reached its level, for water seeks its level.
Close quote. Now, this is a very important point. This is to do with discussing matters that would later be, this is sort of some of what we're calling proto-geology, early studies in geology that would later be perfected and put to pen by Ibn Khaldun and others. So what the Imam Rahimullah is saying is that when valleys are formed by water that comes because of rain and erosion, the rain comes down in between mountains or areas and erodes away rockwork. But as water fills because of either flooding or the erosion process, it runs off. And as water runs off, it leaves marks from what's happened. Now, sometimes the runoff from water can be in the form of rising level, or it can be because of a massive flood. An example of runoff water are places like Rainier Valley, Kent Valley. This area here is a classic case of water runoff forming a valley-type environment here from the River Leen. In fact, it flooded again in 2002 when the water had to seek its level because it overran an embankment, and the area was underwater again like it had been in the past, ancient past. Water that's caused by a massive flood is an example of the Grand Canyon. Now, the Grand Canyon is a brilliant example of a massive flood. Here's why. Water seeks its level, and it normally flows downstream, because water carves and erodes downstream. But what happened when you look at the Grand Canyon is you see that the river that runs through the Grand Canyon is running upstream. What that's telling you is the flood that happened in the Grand Canyon wasn't a gradual erosion process. It was such a spectacular flood that hit that area that it literally violently pushed water, ice, sediment, silt, and other things through limestone and some of the hardest rock known to man, literally forced it through in perhaps a matter of days or weeks. Now, a good many of our Muslim scholars have said that this is the Grand Canyon and similar spectacular structures are the result of the worldwide flood from the time of Nabiyyina Nuh alayhi salam. In response, they're a result of that. So is the Himalayan mountain range. Why? Well, the Himalayan mountain range, I'll touch on it very briefly because we discussed it before. The first climbers to reach the top of Mount Everest found what? They found clams the size of living room tables in the closed position. Massive clams. They found lobsters as big as two living room tables, petrified with their claws closed. Why is that important? Mount Everest belongs to one of the largest, if not the largest, mountain ranges on Earth, the Himalayas. What are marine life doing on the top of the mountain, at the very top of the mountain? What are they doing there? Clams and lobsters don't climb high altitudes. They're not able to get to that level, so how did they get there? But we'll answer the first question is, why are they in the closed position? When crabs and clams die a natural death, the shell pops open and the crab's claws open. But if they die in a flood or in a spectacular death, they are surprised suddenly and they try to pull into a defensive posture. The crab, by closing his claws, the clam by keeping his shell shut. And they're petrified in mud. Now, what does this mean for the second question? Why are they on top of the mountain? Because the tops of the mountains of the Himalayan mountain range were actually part of the ocean floor
during the flood. And in the process of the flood's volcanic eruption that caused pillow volcanoes and other things, giant sections of ocean floor rose up and formed giant mountain ranges. The Himalayan mountain range is an evidence of that. If you get a chance in your spare time, look up the Himalayan mountain range, how marine life was found on the top, lobsters, king crabs, clams, gigantic sizes, as well as ocean floor that matches with the ocean floor we see in the Indian Ocean. That could not be on the top unless the Himalayan mountains in some point in recent geological history were part of the ocean floor at that point, and because of gigantic and spectacular flooding, were risen from the bottom of the ocean floor to the top and formed the jagged, crackled mountain ranges that we see that are called the Himalayas. And you see this all over the earth, which is examples of a gigantic, spectacular, tragic global flood. An example of that. So when the Imam is discussing these matters, he's bringing this to your attention. Something that Ibn Khaldun in his travels and Ibn Battuta and others would later flesh out and systematize. And what people in the United Kingdom, United States, more than 900 years later, would find out in the 1800s, and they would call it, taking from the Greek, geology. Whereas we in Arabic refer to this as ulum al-ard, the science and studies of the earth. And it's classified under the sciences of funun. You study funun after your ulum. Now, the Imam rahimullah, he says, quote, "The Exalted One has said that the water was born that carved these areas and had foam. There was foam resting above the water. And this is the example that Allah gave of the unbeliever, that they are like the froth and filth. And the water, the pure water, is like the believer. Now Allah used the word, وَمِمَّا يُوْقِدُونَ عَلَيْهِ فِي النَّارِ, and of that which was kindled upon it in the fire, meaning the fires under the water on the ground. Now, this has been recited by Ibn Kathir, Nafi', Abu Amr, Ibn Amir, Abu Bakr from Asim as Tuqidun. However, Hamza, Kisa'i, Hafs from Asim say Yuqidun. The Exalted One then says, and whatever goes into, whatever, and from that which had kindled upon it the fire. This is referring to the fire that's under there. Now there's a fire that goes under the ground and is the reason why we have our precious jewels such as gold and silver. It is also from this that you get iron and bronze and lead. These things come in many different colors, and you can make use of them, but one who is schooled in these sciences would only recognize them after deep study and examining the different forms of them. Close quote. Just a very quick point. So the Imam here, rahimahullah, is talking about deep pressures within the earth that cause agate, that cause your jewels. Jawahir is your jewels, like rubies and other things, gold and silver. You may be interested to know this. 90% of all the world's gold was formed in a short period of weeks, some 4,000 to 7,000 years ago, which, if you look at the sediment and mud deposits around the world, coincides with the time immediately preceding a massive worldwide flood. The same thing goes for our silver deposits. So the Imam talking about this, and Imam al-Jawzi rahimahullah lived 900 years ago. There were no universities here. There was grass. There was no Oxford or Cambridge. There was grass. Now he had an observatory in the back of his house, and there were 70 hospitals in Baghdad. And he's writing about this at the time. So the reason why I stress on this so hard is because I want you to understand that we have an amazing, an unbelievable, an enormous
past, and much of what we take for granted today of the things that we are correctly taught were already taught to them, but they translated into Latin, and then it became lost, and they said, we found it, and actually they didn't find it first. But the struggle's not over. You have to reclaim these sciences of metallurgy and geology and archaeology. You have to reclaim these things because it's in here. These are the imams that wrote on these matters. So we just have to reclaim it. Now, just very quickly, when the imam is talking about the different things that are formed because of pressures within the earth, gold and silver and iron and bronze, he says they form in different ages based upon different pressures in the earth. And the only people that recognize these compounds and items when they see them are those who were schooled in the sciences. Meaning, someone that sees a mountain of gold might not recognize it as gold because he doesn't know what to look for. He doesn't know what to look for when he sees silver. Silver does not appear how we see it in the end process because it's usually suspended and trapped inside of rock. Copper is usually suspended and trapped inside of rock. Gold is suspended and trapped inside of rock. So what do you have to do? You have to superheat the gold to separate it from the rock, to pour it into molds off to the side, so then you have pure gold. You then make the gold into shapes, whether it's bricks or jewelry or trinkets or other items. But there's a whole science to this, which is known as smelting. And this is something that they were experimenting with on a wider industrial scale. Nations before Imam Jawzi rahimahullah were doing smelting, but it wasn't on the same level. By Imam Jawzi's time rahimahullah, the Abbasids were actually demolishing mountains. They were moving mountains, demolishing mountains, which is what they're doing now. They're moving mountains from their places, demolishing them and smelting entire mountains of gold and lithium. In Afghanistan, they're mining lithium, because everyone needs that in their mobile phone and their GPS devices. And all of your car and your computer technology and your Wi-Fis and everything else, you need lithium. And the Afghanis happen to have a whole bunch of it, and they don't know exactly what it's used for, but they just know that an entire army's there to mine the lithium, but they're also looking for some shaggy-haired guys in caves too. And they're laying pipelines as well. So if you look at the vast majority of the world's resources, gold, silver, agate, ruby, limestone, copper, it's found in the Muslim countries. 48 majority Muslim countries, the vast majority is found there. Because Allah made certain promises to this ummah and he's kept them. Our issue is we don't know what those promises are. So we often are scratching our heads saying, why are we so poor? And our countries are so mineral rich. And why are the countries that we fled to so wealthy, but they have nothing to export? If all trade was cut off to the UK in terms of coffee, rice, cotton, silver, gold, they would either have to invade a next door country or they would starve in a big way. Egypt, if it cut itself off and it had a really good management project for its land, it could be all right. That's the rice and bread basket of the entire continent of Africa, Egypt. Why are they having bread lines? If the entire section of Punjab just split off and they had a good management project, they could be their own nation and they could forget about India, about Nepal, about Pakistan, and about Sri Lanka, and everyone else around them, and they would be all right. They have 11 of the world's 12 renewable mineral resources. Why on earth are they so poor? And they're Muslim. Why on earth are they so poor? Because they don't know the promises that Allah made to them. Allah made certain promises to them. In Kashmir, Imam Muslim's buried on the other side of it, on the other side of Azad Kashmir. He's waiting for the people to do something. With all the rich mineral resources, his grave is laying on the other side. He's waiting for them to do something. 500 companions buried in Afghanistan, they're waiting for the people there to do something. So it's not that we're poor in the sense that we don't have any minerals. We don't know what promises Allah has made, and we don't know what to do with it. But other nations that are impoverished, the United States, Germany, France, the UK, they're impoverished.
They're getting their natural gas from Algeria. Because Algeria has so much of it, they consider it a nuisance. It's flowing all over the place. It's getting in everything. Get rid of this stuff. They're taking 1 million barrels a day. That's what I'm saying. So when we understand these sciences, the Imam is saying someone has to have deep knowledge of these things. So you need to have people that study smelting, metallurgy, petroleum. That's where we really need to be at, on the ground floor levels, to understand how gold and silver can be found, how petroleum can be found, how agate can be found, how copper can be found, how lithium can be found, learning how to then isolate it, dig for it, take it out, excavate it, and then systematically make it so that it's profitable for the people that are there. We have all the doctors and the dentists and the barristers going back, which are doing nothing but burying all the poor dead people, putting blankets on them, and arguing in court over the inheritance, because that's all that we have going back there. When in reality, what we need to go back there is people that smelt iron and people that do all these the real basic stuff, your electricians and all your other guys, to really build it up. And the Imam's told you what all the building blocks are. You just need to follow it. The Imam, rahimullah, he then says, quote, "You must understand that Allah making the parable between the filth of the unbelievers, which is as a froth on top of the ocean. Allah has made it clear in this matter. He stated that the Quran, its coming as revelation from the sky, is like water. And the hearts of the slaves are like valleys that are carved with this water. Some of these valleys have certainty and some have doubt. Some have intellect and some are ignorant. The believer benefits from what's in his heart, just like the earth benefits from the water that comes from rain and settles and makes valleys. The unbeliever doesn't benefit from the Quran. It only causes him doubt and unbelief. And the result of that unbelief is he becomes like filth. And he becomes unpurified like the iron in the earth. And when iron is unpurified and unexcavated, it cannot be benefited from and becomes a poison. Truth and falsehood are the same way. Truth is like pure water that remains pure on its natural state. Falsehood is like the filth that comes. And even if it's on top of the water, it mixes with it and it pollutes it, just like falsehood pollutes. Now, even if falsehood sometimes appears dominant over the truth, Allah will negate falsehood, even though at times it seems like it is predominant. Allah gives the example of the believer and the unbeliever. He gives the example of the believer. His belief and his actions are like pure water that someone takes benefit from. But the unbeliever, his actions and his beliefs are like froth. Nothing comes from it. Now, likewise, Allah gives other parables. Other parables where Allah says, and likewise, whatever people benefit from, what that is referring to is the same thing discussed earlier, meaning water and the jewels and other minerals taken from the earth. And the truth belongs with the people of truth. Those who answer their Lord, meaning the believers, and those who didn't answer, meaning the unbelievers, all those categories will be judged. The believers will have al-husna, the good, and the good here is referring to the paradise, which is the vast majority of scholars and Ibn Abbas understand. Also, it means that they shall have life and sustenance that Allah gives them, and every good from the paradise and whatever its different levels are. And this was mentioned by Mujahid and Abu Ubaidah. The unbelievers, when they are finally brought to account, they will wish that they could offer up all the earth as a ransom for themselves. But it won't be accepted from them. because they will be tried and reckoned for what they did when they were on earth. They'll be reckoned for their sins and no forgiveness will be brought for them. No good deeds will be accepted from them. And no sin that they did will be passed over. All this has been narrated by Ibn Abbas, Ibrahim al-Nakhai, the Sheikh of Hamad, who was the Sheikh of Imam Abu Hanifa, rahimahullah, and also the other scholars. When Allah says, "So then who knows that this has only been sent down to you from your Lord as the truth? Is this one like the blind man?" Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu says, "The reason why this ayah was sent down is because Allah was making a comparison between Hamza ibn Abdul Muttalib, who knew that this ayah was the truth and the Quran was the truth, and Abu Jahl, who knew it was the truth but was blind." So here Allah, the two people that Allah is comparing, the one who knows that it's sent down to you, that is Hamza, and the one who's blind, which is Abu Jahl. And those who remember are the people of understanding, meaning they have sound intellects and they take heed. And those who, they keep the covenant of Allah and they don't nullify it. Now the covenant of Allah is referring to that when they were taken from the back of Nabiuna Adam alayhi salam and asked, "Am I not your Lord?" They said, "Indeed." Surah Al-A'raf, the 7th surah, ayah 172. The second is also whatever Allah commanded them to do, what was fard, that which Allah commanded them to do, that which they were told they must do, things that Allah enjoined upon them. We already discussed this in Surah Al-Baqarah, the 2nd surah, ayah 27. So we won't mention it again. Those who are patient on what they've been commanded to do, and they seek the face of their Lord, and they seek His pleasure. They establish the prayer, meaning they complete it. They spend of that which we've given them, meaning the wealth. So they use their wealth to obey Allah. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu says, when Allah says that they establish the prayer, it means that they make the 5-time salawat. And the spending is referring to zakah. And that they remove a bad deed with a good deed. So they take a righteous deed and the righteous deed cancels out an evil deed. They cancel out wickedness with righteousness. They cancel out oppression with goodness. They cancel out deceit with forbearance. They cancel out a sin with tawbah. And all of this was mentioned and narrated by Ibn Abbas, Sa'id ibn Jubayr, Juwaybir, and also Ibn Qutayba and Ibn Kisan. Allah then says that the righteous people, they have the best end. The best end means, in this ayah, according to Ibn Abbas, the paradise. That is the end of all things. And the righteous people that came before them. So He, Allah, mentions the righteous people and their ancestors that were righteous. And the angels that shall come on to the people from every gate. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu says, every gate is referring to the gates of paradise and that they're coming with a greeting from Allah. And bearing gifts. And all of those aforementioned say, peace be upon you. And so what's being given by the salam here is that it's the well-known greeting of the Muslims. And the angels will come giving this greeting. And the statement here referred to is the salam here of assalamu alaikum or salamun alaikum. As-salam is one of the names of Allah, mighty and majestic. So it's saying, the peace of Allah, His salvation be upon you. May Allah preserve you. You have safety and salvation. And Allah has saved you from the fright and terrors of the day of resurrection and its evil. You were patient in this earthly life, and He's now rewarding you with additional things in the paradise for your patience. This was mentioned by Sa'id ibn Jubayr, Al-Hasan al-Basri, Abu Imran al-Jawni, and Ibn Zayd. And those who nullified their covenant. Again, we've already discussed about the nullification of the covenant. Surah Al-Baqarah, the second surah, 27. Muqatil also says that those who nullify their covenant are also the Jews and Christians. And those who nullify the covenant, they have the eternal curse upon them. And Allah spreads out the sustenance to whoever He wills, meaning He spreads out the sustenance to everyone who is to receive it. And some people have their sustenance tightened. The idol worshippers, though, they rejoice in that which they have attained from the earthly life. They rejoice in that which they have retained of the earthly life, and then they become arrogant and reject the messengers. But the earthly life is only temporary and will pass away, as Allah says, that it's only mata', that which will pass away. Now those who are unbelievers say, why is there not sent down upon him a sign? This ayah was revealed because the idol worshippers said, for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to bring down signs, just like all the prophets had brought before. But he said, indeed, Allah leads astray who He wills. Meaning that whoever is to leave guidance, whoever shall not be guided, will not be guided. And Allah has sent down signs, but only those meant to be guided will accept them. And He guides to Him whoever He so wills, meaning those who are to return to the truth are those who Allah has willed. So He guides who He wills. They are those who believe, and their hearts are content. Their hearts are content with the remembrance of Allah, the dhikr Allah. This dhikr is referring to two things. Number one, it's referring to the Quran. Number two, it's referring to doing dhikr of Allah in general. They are content with the dhikr of Allah in general. And so this contentment is love and pleasure to do the dhikr of Allah, in addition to peace and tranquility without doubt. This is the opposite of those who, when Allah is mentioned, their hearts become apprehensive. Is it not in the remembrance of Allah that the hearts find tranquility? Meaning that the hearts are tranquil. The believers' hearts are tranquil. But the hearts of the unbelievers are not tranquil. Allah says good news to those who believe. Tuba, good news, is also referring to the fact that it's the name of a tree in the paradise. It was narrated by Abu Sa'id al-Khudri from the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who said, a man once came and said, Messenger of Allah, what does Tuba mean? He said, it is a tree in the paradise. in which to ride in its shade to reach it is 100 years. The clothing of the people of the paradise shall come from this very tree. And this is collected by Imam Ahmed in his Musnad. Abu Huraira radiallahu anhu has said that indeed it is a tree in the paradise. And Allah the Exalted has said the truth. Shahr ibn Hushab has said that Tuba is a tree in the paradise, and every tree in the paradise has its foliage from behind the gates of the paradise. This was also stated by Atiyah and Shamr ibn Atiyah, Mughith ibn Sumah, Abu Salih, and others. Tuba is also the name of the paradise in the Amharic language. So this is a foreign word that's come into Arabic. This was stated by Sa'id ibn Jubayr from Ibn Abbas. However, I spoke to one of my sheikhs and he said this word also may have a root that's coming from Hindi. This was also stated by Ikrimah ibn Abi Jahl and Mujahid. Tuba in the verbal form is referring to, and not the nominal sense, is referring to glad tidings, happiness. So glad tidings for that one, if you're talking about this in the verbal sense. Good for them. Good and tranquility for them. Now this is a word that's come into Arabic, but it's become an Arabic word now. A good life for them. All of these statements stand up. And they have a good outcome when they come back to Allah. And Allah said, and likewise we sent you, meaning, just as we sent the prophets before you, we sent you. And they reject faith in Al-Rahman. The reason why this ayah was revealed is because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he said to the unbelievers, prostrate to Al-Rahman, they said, what is Al-Rahman? We don't know what that is. And so this ayah was revealed. And he said after, Al-Rahman is the one who you reject. He is my Lord. And this has been narrated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. The unbelievers scratched out the name Al-Rahman as well in the Treaty of Hudaybiyah. For Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu wrote out, Bismillahir Rahman Yar Rahim. Suhail ibn Amr looked and said, we don't know of anyone called Al-Rahman among us. There's only one man among us whose name is Musaylima, and he knows Al-Rahman, but we don't know what this name means. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam also one day was making dua at the Kaaba, and Abu Jahl came and listened to his dua and heard him saying, Ya Rahman, O Rahman. And he turned away to the idol worshippers and he said, Muhammad has forbade us from the worship of several gods, but he's calling on two gods, one called Allah and one called Al-Rahman. What is happening? So Allah has sent this ayah down to answer all of these incidents. And to him, is the ultimate return, meaning to Allah is the ultimate return.
Close quote. Now, something very quickly. The idol worshippers, when they had names for their idols, they would only have one name. So, Lat, Uzza, Manat. That was the only name. So, when the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that Allah has 99 beautiful names, they immediately thought there must be several gods, because how can one god have several names? It must be several different gods. Now, the scholars of theology and law, they all say that in the Quran and the Sunnah, Allah has described himself with 3,000 names and attributes. 3,000 names and attributes. These names and attributes are summarized in the most beautiful names, which are the 99. And those 99 can be summarized into the 14 most mentioned attributes and names that Allah uses in the Quran. So you have 14, 99, 3,000. So if you know the 14, you really know the rest, although you don't know where they're all located. If you know the 99, you know the rest, although you don't know where they're located. I strongly advise, because it was taught to us when we entered into seminary, that you need to know the 99 names of Allah. One of the mahads I visited, that was one of the entrance things they tested you on, is do you know the 99 names? How can I teach you the book of Allah? You want to memorize the book of Allah and you don't know him. That's the stress that they put on it. So they weren't saying that the individual wasn't Muslim, but they were saying that you have to prioritize what it is you want to do. So just like you memorize the Quran before you study hadith, you have different things that you do. Well, memorizing the 99 names is one of the things that is something to do, and it gives you a much greater and powerful impact when you know these 99 names and then you see them in the Quran. It's powerful. And you realize that Allah is Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, Al-Malik, Al-Quddus, but he's also Al-Adl. He's also Shadid Al-Iqab. He's also swift in punishment. He's also Sari Al-Hisab, quick to take account. He's also Ahsan Al-Khaliqeen, the best creator. He's also Ahkim Al-Hakimeen. Those are like from the Quran. Those are additional ones. But the 99 names, they're from Al-Rahman all the way to Al-Sabur. And most of the places that you can locate where they have Muslim centers and places, you can obtain the big poster. And if you really put your mind to it, you could do all 99 in probably an hour. If you really put your mind to it, you could probably do it in an hour. If you had nothing else to do, and you were undisturbed, and no one bothered you, and your mind and soul were at peace, you could probably do it in an hour. Let's say you can. Let's say you say, no, that's too big of an order, that's just too tall. Okay, that's fine. Try 10 a day. In 10 days, you're done. You say, well, I couldn't do that. Okay, try a month. Try a month. Don't go any further than a month, though. Because then you might loop, because it needs to be a challenge as well as easy. So it shouldn't be too easy to where you lose the challenge, but it shouldn't be too challenging where you think, oh, I might not be able to finish it. So just start out, maybe even put it on flashcards. Print them out, put them on flashcards. Learn them, flip it over, look at the meaning if you don't know the Arabic meaning. Look at the meaning, flip it back over. Try it again. And do that every day, and then jumble them up. And have someone just test you. Say, okay, Al-Adl, the just. Al-Hakam, the judge. Okay, how about Malikul Mulk, the owner of all dominion? Just try it out. And you'll be amazed at how more powerful your dua is, how more heartfelt it is, how much more you have to say, how much more you realize who's in control of all things. You will be amazed at the impact it has on your life if you learn those. Makes your dua longer too. But you would be surprised the power that's in it. There's amazing power. And that's why the companions, sometimes if you look at some of the companions, and then the early generations I'll mention very quickly. There's a dua from Imam Abu Umar al-Maqdisi rahimahullah. He's the older brother of Imam Muwafiquddin. Imam Muwafiquddin is the great alim who walked on water. He's famous for walking on water in terms of his karamat. His older brother Abu Umar al-Maqdisi has a book that was written about him. It's a book that's two thick volumes detailing all his karamat. Two volumes as big as my fist, each volume. When he was asked, what do you attribute your longevity to? And all these karamat that Allah has blessed you with. He said, the speech of Allah, meaning the Quran, and using Allah's names in my du'as. Knowing the names. So he didn't give a formula. He didn't say, I was given this wazifa, or my sheikh gave me this to read every day. He didn't say that. And I'm not downplaying that, because sometimes certain sheikhs, if they've had a tremendous benefit with using Ar-Rahman Ar-Rahim or Hu Al-Ali Al-Azim or things like that, there can be benefit in that. I'm not denying that. But a lot of times people were looking for, okay, was he given something? But sometimes the answer to the question isn't what you were given, it's what's already there. So it's something that was already there. And so he took it and he used it. So the next time, when you're asking Allah for something, use the names like Al-Mujib, the one that answers dua. Al-Ghaffar, the one that forgives sins. Right? Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, As-Salam, As-Sabur, Al-Quddus, the Holy. Use those ones in your dua. And when you're seeking Allah's forgiveness for sins, right? Use all the names of mercy. Ar-Rahman, Ar-Rahim, right? Al-Ghaffar, Al-Ghafur, Al-Wadud, all these names, right? And when you're remembering Allah's judgments and saying, oh Allah, this has happened today and it's been very difficult for me and I've been teased, or this has happened to the house, or this has been damaged, use Allah's names of judgment. Al-Hakam, Al-Adl, Malik al-Mulk, Dhul Jalali wal-Ikram, his names of might and power and dignity. Right, where there was one woman, the woman of Sa'diyah, I'll mention very quickly. There was a man who used to always curse her from the unbelievers. And this happened every day, and she would have things thrown on her and she'd have to change her clothes. And one day she walked by him and she looked at him and she just said, Dhul Jalali wal Ikram, and he died. So when you know whose property you are, people know better than to mess with you. Because we're all property. Someone's. So when people understand that you're marked, cats and dogs have collars around their neck. Muslim men, it's the clothes, the beard, or some peach fuzz on the face. That's the evidence that we're property of somebody's. But the Muslim woman, it's the clothing, the khimar, and the other things. That's evidence they're property. What happens if you mess with people's property? Like, if we look in a dunya example, what happens if you mess with someone's cat or their dog? You get arrested, you get a fine, you could go to jail, or get a 5,000 pound fine. What happens if you mess with the property of Allah? Well, innumerable things could go wrong. The end result is judgment. So for property, we have to make sure that we show our collar. So if lost, please return to Allah. Now, Imam Al-Jawzi rahimahullah, he says, quote, it should also be remembered when Allah said, if the Quran had been sent and it moved mountains, or caused the earth to split open, or the dead to speak, they still wouldn't believe. Allah has full control over the matter. The reason why this ayah was revealed is because the idol worshippers of the Quraysh, they said to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam one day, if the earth was folded up and the valleys were tightened with the Quran, or the mountains were moved from their places, or the dead were raised, we'd believe then. But this ayah was sent down to say that they wouldn't. And this was narrated by Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. Az-Zubayr ibn al-Awwam, one of the 10 promised paradise, he said, the Quraysh one day said to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, call on Allah, tell him to move the mountains from their places, split the earth open,
and cause rivers to flow for vegetation, or resurrect some dead people to us so we can speak to them, or tell him to split this rock open and let gold come out in big rivulets. So then we'll have wealth in the winter and the summertime. And the prophets, didn't they do this before? So Allah answered them with this ayah. Allah also sent down, وَمَا مَنَعَنَا أَن نُرْسِلَ بِالْآيَاتِ إِلَّا أَن كَذَّبَ بِهَا الْأَوَّلُونَ. We did not stop the case that we sent down signs, except that the nations of before rejected them whenever we sent the signs. And when Allah says the earth to split open, it means that rivers and valleys would form, and the dead to be raised. They wanted the dead to be raised so they could speak to them. And they said they would believe if the dead were raised. If all of this was done, they said that they would believe. But the reality is what Allah had said, as we mentioned in Surah An'am, even if we sent to them the angels in legions. Surah An'am, the sixth surah, ayah 111. Even if the angels were sent in legions, they would not believe. Allah has the command, all of it. Meaning, if He wants that they should believe, they would have believed. And if He doesn't, He does what He wills. It doesn't matter what signs are shown, they would not benefit from any signs if He, Allah, had not written for them to believe. And so, let not those who believe lose hope when they see the unbelievers rejecting faith. Because despair happens due to a lack of knowledge. There's something that's causing you to doubt that's leading you to despair. And despair comes from a lack of certainty. And sometimes the believers would feel bad that the unbelievers wouldn't become Muslim. But if Allah had willed, all of humanity would have been guided. So let the believers not become sad about the affair, because these people are those who Allah described them that they will not believe. And those who reject faith will continue to do so. So this is a general ayah regarding all the unbelievers, particularly the Meccans who rejected faith consistently. And Allah uses the word qadi'ah. Now qadi'ah is qadi'ah in Arabic is a terrible clamor. And it's the punishment that Allah could send down from the sky upon them in the context of this ayah. So He, Allah, has made the matter clear. But they came to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and they said, well, why don't you bring on the punishment? But He, Allah, has told them when the punishment will come. And the punishment for them, the earthly punishment, was the conquest of Mecca. And hereafter, punishment is what's coming on the Day of Judgment. And every soul shall have what it earned. Everything is written down, the design of the soul, its sustenance, how long it shall live, the preservation of its deeds. Every soul shall have what it earned. So this description is clear. Those who worship idols, their end shall come. They've made partners for Allah. And the response was to tell the idol worshippers, so then name them, describe these idols. How can you follow something when Allah has described Himself as the creator, the sustainer, the giver of life, the giver of death? They don't have these names, so there's no point in following them. They will be informed. Are these idols informed in the same way that Allah knows all things? No, not at all. Allah knows what they don't know. But the unbelievers have had their deeds made fair-seeming to them. Who is the one that made their deeds fair-seeming to them? Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu says, this is a direct reference, this is an indirect reference to Shaytan, who has made their deeds fair-seeming to them. And he has prevented them from the path, meaning the path of righteousness, and the path of Iman, and the path of guidance. And they have a punishment in this earthly life, which means that the unbelievers, some of them were killed, taken prisoners, and laid low, and humiliated. This is the punishment in the earthly life. As for the believers, in the earthly life, they will be having whatever dispensations and tribulations that they have. The punishment of the hereafter is worse. So there's no protection from Allah from the punishment of the hereafter. An example of the paradise under which rivers are flowing. This is the very paradise we've discussed before, as mentioned by the vast majority. So the paradise that's been mentioned has rivers flowing, and vegetation and shadows and shade that are forever. Although there's no sun in the paradise. Rather, its light is coming from somewhere else. And that is the end result for those who truly believe and fear Allah. Those who we gave them the book, meaning that this is referring to those who became Muslims from the Jews, like Abdullah ibn Salam. These people who became companions to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as discussed by Ibn Abbas and Qatada. The Christians as well. All of these people, when they became Muslims, they rejoiced and they testified to it. All those who testified to the truth of it, because they could see signs of this in their book that they had. The idol worshippers rejected faith, and this ayah was sent down due to that. The unbelievers broke into parties against the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam with mutual hatred and enmity between them. So you have Jews and Christians and fire worshippers who agreed to show hatred to the Messenger of Allah. And among the idol worshippers you had the Banu Umayyah and the Banu Mughira and the Ala Abi Talha and others from among the idol worshippers of the Quraysh. They rejected Allah as the most merciful. They rejected that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that had been sent. Although they knew that he'd been sent in their books, the Jews and Christians denied his prophethood, and they knew that he was telling the truth. They denied his truthfulness. And this was all discussed by Mawirdi and others, and Qatada. Allah says, likewise we sent it, meaning the Qur'an was sent just as the books were sent to the messengers before in their own languages. The Qur'an was sent down to you as a judgment and a ruling in Arabic. And the Hukman Arabiyya, Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, that means all of your compulsory things that you need to know have been sent down to you in a deen that is in Arabic. And if you follow their desires, meaning if you followed them in their desires when the Jews told you you need to face Jerusalem forever like how we do, then you would have been led astray. And you would have had no protector from Allah, from his punishment or his wrath. Allah said, we sent messengers before you. Now the reason why this was revealed is because the Jews, they picked fault at the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because they said, why do you have all of these wives? If he was a prophet, just as he claimed, then his prophethood would have kept him busy from getting married to wives. But this ayah was sent down as a confirmation that all the prophets before the great majority of them had wives and children. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu mentioned this. And so this is a command that comes from the messengers. And no messenger comes with a sign except by the command of Allah. And every time has its book, meaning every time has something that Allah has created it for, and every purpose. And everything that comes down is ordained. Every matter has been preordained. Every judgment has been given by Allah, as stated by Ibn Jarir al-Tabari. And He, Allah, wipes out what He wills and establishes what He wills. So He, Allah, has made it clear that He decides regarding and wipes out sustenance, lifespan, judgment, wrath, wickedness. He is in the one who does abrogation and the abrogated. He abrogates what He wills and establishes what He wills. Those who die and those who live, He wipes out and establishes what He wills. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, "You should know that when a sperm drop passes 45 nights, the angel in charge of entrusting it says, 'Shall it be a male or female?' And Allah gives the judgment. And the angel writes it down and he says, 'Is this one of wrath or one of salvation?' And Allah ordains that. And the angel writes that. He says, 'What shall be his actions and his lifespan?' And Allah ordains that. And the angel writes that. Then he coils up the scroll. And nothing is increased and nothing is decreased from it." So He, Allah, has given all things. He wipes out the sins of His slaves and establishes and forgives the good that they've left behind. He wipes out sins with repentance and establishes in their place good deeds. He wipes out whatever accounts that the preserving angels might have that He doesn't want them to have when He forgives His slave. He, Allah, wipes out some reward and some punishment. He establishes reward and He establishes punishment. All things are written. Everything has its reward and its time. What they will eat, what you ate, what you drank, how you did when you went out, how you did when you came in. This is true. All of this is true. And He has the source of the book. As Zajjaj has said, it means the foundation of the book, because the foundation of the book is the preserved tablet, which has in it all that is and all that shall come to be. And this can be seen in the last ayah of Surah Al-Buruj. It was related by Abu Darda from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam that he said, "Allah the Exalted when there remains from the night 3 hours, He looks in the book and no one looks at it other than Him. And He, Allah, wipes out what He wills and He establishes what He wills." This is collected by Imam al-Tabari. The same has been narrated from Ikrimah from Ibn Abbas, who said, "There are two books. There's a book besides the mother book of all things, in which He wipes things from it and He establishes things in it. Then there's also the mother book in which there's no change in that." So there are some things that are wiped out and changed and some things that are not changed. Allah says, and there are others who they leave or reject some of that which has come. And there's punishment coming to them, although you're alive and you see. But when they're taken in death, you are not their preserver. Your job is to deliver the message. And we will reckon them and reward them for what they've done. Your job is to give the message. Now this was regarding the Arabs before the ayat of jihad were revealed in Surah Tawbah, the ninth surah, 5. After that, the fard of jihad was given. Allah then said, do they not see that we have brought the earth and spread it out and decreased it from its sides? Now this ayah is showing that Allah has shown his prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam the earth, spread it out and showed it to him. But particularly the land of Mecca and what's around it. And that it shall be destroyed in the end of days. And it was starting the process of its destruction at that time. The people and the barakah of the people will slowly decrease over time. So shall the crops. Also the fuqaha and the best of the people shall decrease over time. But Allah judges and there's no one that can stop his judgment. There's no change in his judgment, there's no decrease. We've already discussed this in Surah Al-Baqarah, the second surah, 202. So one can refer back to it. And already those from before them planned, but Allah knows all of what they planned. The unbelievers of the nations of the past planned, but Allah already knew their plan. They planned with their prophets. They planned against their prophets, seeking to kill them, just as the Quraysh sought to kill the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But Allah laid waste to their plans, and nothing goes to pass except by His will. He knows what every soul is to get from evil and good, benefit and gain, harm and help. Nothing comes about except by His will. And the idol worshiper and the unbeliever shall surely come to know. And they have the end result. Those believers have the end result, which is the paradise. The unbelievers have the end result, which is eternal judgment. Those who reject faith, the unbelievers of Quraysh and the Jews and the Christians, they say, you've not been sent as a messenger. Say, Allah is a witness between me and between you. Meaning all the signs of my prophethood and what's been given is a clear sign. And He, Allah, has with Him the knowledge of the book. Now, the knowledge of the book is imparted as well to the scholars of the Jews and Christians who understand what the Quran means. People such as Abdullah ibn Salam, who understood this. Some of the people of the book who bear witness of the truth of the Qur'an. As we already said, Abdullah ibn Salam, as well as Salman al-Farisi, who was a Christian. And Tamim al-Dari, who was also a Christian. The angel Jibreel alayhi salam knows the truth of this book and brings it. But also the one who knows the truth of the book is Ali ibn Abi Talib radiallahu anhu, the Qadi of the Ummah. Benjamin knew the truth of the book in the time of his brother Nabi Yusuf alayhi salam. So all of this is true. All of this knowledge. And the book was sent down from the knowledge of Allah, for it is His speech indeed. Close quote.
أقول قولي هذا أستغفر الله لي ولكم. أستغفر الله إن الله غفور رحيم يرحم الراحمين. Now we have finished Surah Al-Ra'ad, that is the 13th surah. Inshallah, I will give everyone a rest this starting this Friday, a rest. So we will stop here and people have their rest in Ramadan, because I was thinking about it. This is going to be the hottest Ramadan that we will encounter in quite some time. And even if there's 1 week of sunny days, you're looking at a suhoor that will probably end at around 2:12, and a maghrib that will come at 9:30 or somewhere around there. So inshallah, you'll have time to prepare yourselves, to acclimate yourselves, to hydrate yourselves, and we will stop here. Are there questions for what we covered? Yes. Question is regarding the 3 hours in the night where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala erases things from the book and establishes things in the book. Alhamdulillah, salatu wa rasulillah. There is some portion of the night where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there are certain things that can be rubbed out and certain things that are established and stay as they are. We don't know what all of them are, but we do know from some ahadith, like for example, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said in a hadith in Sahih al-Jami'a, that in one hadith he said, visiting the ill increases your sustenance, your rizq, and so does visiting and being good to your parents. But we've been told another hadith in Bukhari and Muslim that your sustenance is preordained. Yet we've been told here that it can increase your sustenance. So what do? We accept both of them. Because it's one of the things where Allah says there can be change in this. So if you look after your parents, you're good to your parents, Allah increases your sustenance. There's another hadith where if you have children, Allah increases your sustenance to deal with your children. Right? So these are examples where things happen. Or the case where Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam, the angel of death, came to him and said that it is time. But Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam rejected it. And he went back to Allah. And the angel of death came back. And he said, if you want, you can live as many hairs as you see in the wool of this sheep, or you can choose to die now. He said, I choose to die now. So here you have an example that Nabiullah Musa alayhi salam was given a choice when he died. But then on the other side, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given the same choice, to stay behind or to go ahead with the angels on high. And he said, I'll go with the angels on high. But the fact that he was given a choice to live longer indicates that there's some choice in the matter. Now, is that for everyone? Well, I don't know. But the fact that it's there shows that for some people, they've been given a choice of going longer. And some people have given a choice of having increased rizq. You'll have another example where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has talked about in a hadith of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, where he said that your death has been given, and if your time comes and this doesn't hit you, then something else will hit you. And that gives the indication, Imam An-Nawawi and others, that possibly the way that you die could be different. So it may be that a man is meant to die at 12:22. He's going to be ran over by a bus, but he becomes deterred because he's eating toast or something like this. So instead, the roof of his house caves in. But one way or another, he dies. But there's a myriad of ways he could die. Now, the question is, okay, how much of this do we know that can be changed, and how much of it do we know that can't? Well, that's just it. We don't know how much of it can, how much of it can't. But we have the indications from the hadith that in certain areas like sustenance and lifespan, that they can be increased or decreased. We do know that. If it's for everyone, I don't know. But we do know in certain cases that that is true. And the Prophet ﷺ, he indicated this. That's the most I can say. Is there another question? Yes.
Salam. What do you mean by the best of people will decrease over time?
All right. The question is, what is meant when the Imam mentioned the best of people decreasing over time? Alhamdulillah. Salatu wa rasulillah. The Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, the best of generations is my generation, then those who come next, then those who come next. All scholars understand that's the companions, the students of the companions, and the students of the students of the companions. The last of that period ends with Imam Ahmed's death. He's the last of that period. Now, then they said, one of the companions said, what comes after that? He said, after that come people who swear by Allah and they weren't asked to swear, and they bear false witness and they lie.
So then there's another hadith where he says, a time will come in which every time after will be worse than the one before. He then gives a hadith where he says, in another hadith in Sahih al-Jami'ah, where he mentioned that a time will come in which the scholars will die. And they won't die because of knowledge disappearing, but rather the death of the ulama. And people will take ignorant leaders as their heads. And they will seek fatwa for them. And they will give it to them. And they will lead themselves astray and lead others astray. So you have this issue of a depletion of ulama. There was a time where ulama who knew several hundred thousand ahadith was commonplace. Imam Ahmed knew all the ahadith, 1 million. Bukhari knew 500,000. Imam Abu Dawood knew 500,000. Imam Muslim knew 400,000. But there was a time where things like that were commonplace. Now, you'll find like most of the muhaddithin of this era are sort of coasting around the 200,000, 300,000 period. And that's like the best of the best of the best. I mean, 200,000 to 300,000, Imam Ahmed, you couldn't even sit in his classes. 400,000 was what Imam Ahmed considered a faqih. You could sit in his class. A lot of the big ulama, they're judges. I don't doubt them. They're judges. They're maraji'. They couldn't sit with Imam Ahmed in his time. Because they don't know enough hadith. They don't know enough hadith. So the ulama have decreased. And so now you have people that are been taken as ulama when they're really not. They're bearing, you know, titles, and those titles actually aren't theirs. So they'll be a massive scholar, huge, and he'll give a ruling. But people will dismiss him because this guy over here, he's been to Scotland or to Cambridge, and he's got a degree in business management or whatever else, and he tells them the total opposite, and he's a layman. But people call that guy Sheikh, and the one who really is the alim, who really is the judge, he'll be mocked and ridiculed. And we have that in this day and age now, where people will be, yes, they'll mock this person. And I'll give you an example. Imam al-Buti rahimahullah, Imam Muhammad Sa'id Ramadan al-Buti, he was one of the great maraji' who was murdered recently in Jumad al-Akhir. He was once in Holland. And he visited Holland. And he's there. So he's sitting there, big amama. You've seen pictures of him. Sitting there, frosty beard. And he's fielding questions about really complex global issues. And someone says, what would you advise us to do with regards to benefiting from the books of the European Fatwa Council? Because we've sought great benefit from them and we've learned a great deal from them. What would you say going forward? He said, in order to be a European fatwa council, in order to have a fatwa council, there's the assumption that the individuals are muftis or fuqaha. The council that you have mentioned, none of the individuals fit that profile. They are therefore liars and you can't take from them. What's the next question? But there are people who depend on that council. They literally depend on that council. And there are other people who have massive crowds of people that are following them, and they're not fuqaha. They're not marja. They're not worthy of taqlid. But there's people doing taqlid of them. Where the actual marja of taqlid, the actual people who you're supposed to do taqlid to, who are in charge of the global and temporal and spiritual affairs of the ummah, they say, well, those are just some old guys. But this guy here, he's been to Surrey, and he studied this. Or this man, he has a degree in IT. I like him. But this guy, he doesn't have a degree in IT. He's a judge, he's a marja. He said, well, I don't know anything about this guy. I don't trust him, I don't know. He doesn't even know English, because that's the passport to everything, isn't it? I mean, the Quran came down and got in Cambridge, didn't it? Rather than Mecca. So because of that, those people are mistrusted. And so it's led to that tribulation. So when it means the best of people decrease, it's talking about scholars, the righteous people, so on and so forth. Yes, Is there a question? Another question? No? Okay. So then inshallah, if there's no further questions, we will break for Ramadan, inshallah. So this will be our last class of Tafsir. We'll break for Ramadan, inshallah. And we ask that you make dua for the slaves of Allah. Subhanakallahumma bihamdika. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. Innahu ghafurur rahim. Yarhamir rahimin. Wassalamu alaykum.